Today, we're going to talk about why AI is really only being used as a code assistant right now, and why AI coders really haven't hit the mark. Industry-leading AI coders like Devin are supposed to be these kind of like first AI software engineers. They're supposed to be able to replace members of the development team with potentially like a junior developer, somebody who may be familiar with code, but maybe isn't like this as skilled as your best developer. And while Devin is sort of a very interesting kind of solution to this, and there have been many other kind of code tools like this, other critics have kind of come out and said like, hey, you know, this was kind of a lie. There was some kind of fakeness in how Devin is sort of actually being used and what it's really capable of. And this goes along with a lot of the other kind of AI problem that are happening right now. If you go on MPKBHD's channel, the last couple of reviews of major AI products have been big misses. Really. And so we're kind of hitting this hype wave in a way where we really aren't getting the things that people are kind of promoting. There's a lot of marketing hype around things, but the idea of creating an AI coder is cool. So why haven't we gotten there yet? Where I really think it all starts is really the context or like the domain of the work that we're coding in. There's a lot of different types of coding that you do. And I've been using AI in my work. So I use like Claude, I use Gemini, and I've been using ChatGPT quite a bit. I've tried also Dolphin and a few other kind of open coding tools. And throughout all that experience, I've kind of seen like the pros and cons of using an AI to kind of assist me in my code. I will say that like my current favorite AI coding interface is Continue right now. I think that the way that they kind of integrate context into sort of the prompts is really innovative and really excellent for what it does. But you're still kind of doing a lot of manual work to help these systems sort of understand what is the code that they should be generating. So like that's the part that matters. This context domain of like what we're doing matters a lot. And I kind of split this into like four examples. There's a lot more. And the way I'm going to go through these examples is from kind of a front end perspective, but I'll keep it general so you can relate to my explanation. So first up, we really have like these like user interfaces. And effectively, like when you're building a user interface, you're not just writing code for like a visual element. You're actually writing a lot of code that relates to how those elements are set up. So usually you're in some sort of frame, you're in a system of some sort, right? So on the web, you're coding for a specific browser and usually modern browsers, older browsers. You're usually using a framework to work on top of that browser. Sometimes you could do native, you could do HTMX. There's a lot of different tools for this, but usually you're using a framework. On top of that, you're usually using some set of styles. Usually if it's a style library, that helps the AI quite a bit in terms of its ability to code because it has something kind of reference. Then you've got some language constraint of, hey, when you generate code, please kind of keep it in this context of the language. But on top of that, you also have custom configuration. So you may have certain styles that you have pulled in and attached to the style library, configurations that you've made. And this makes this kind of like this large chain dependency of this system. User interfaces are hard to maintain. That's really kind of the biggest challenge. We do a lot of work to do snapshot testing or visual testing of these different interfaces because the breakages are usually not something that's functional. Usually they're experiential in a way. And so you want to be able to make sure that you can kind of test those things. Sometimes it takes a lot of manual effort. And so, you know, when we're expecting a AI to be able to do this, to be able to go through this whole thing, we really want it to be able to like integrate with existing code, right? We want it to respect dynamic aspects of this, of these elements, right? We want it to, if we've got hover states where like you hover over something, it changes color. If you've got touch or focus or animations that kind of key in, all of that stuff needs to continue to work through your AI coders refactors, right? They can't be kind of destroying things as they go to be able to get something new in. That wouldn't be how a well-intentioned coder goes about these things. It needs to look good across different viewports. If you look at like the latest like Fallout release, they have a huge number of issues with ultra-wide screens because, and game developers often have issues with ultra-wide screens because they just don't expect a screen to be that wide. So it's often tested less, and a similar goes for a lot of websites haven't traditionally worked on mobile. for the same reason. Maybe not something that that website developer was testing. And the other thing is, because web code moves so fast, you've got to be on the latest code. So you may, the AI needs to know sort of like the context of like what code is available to it. And that's kind of true of all, but I think it's especially true when you start thinking about like frameworks and the interactions between these different kind of pieces. That then starts to get to be where version conflicts start to become a problem. So this is a challenging space, I would say. And when I've asked AI to help assist me and help kind of go all the way to write something for me, I often need to do a lot of coaching because there are so many pieces to this. Sometimes I'll ask it to come up with plans and do some sort of like a chain of thought type thinking. That sometimes like some of the chains just really don't make any sense. Some of the steps are incomplete or inaccurate. There's a lot of guidance that you have to do like manually to kind of get it to think in the right way about how to solve a problem. And sometimes it just hallucinates a guess that should be right. Even given context or even given the ability to make website requests or searches, it still may come up with the wrong answers. So I find user interface is a very difficult challenge for an AI to get right. Like it's one of the first places we kind of think about. We think about like, oh, okay, like, I mean, Vercel even has like a AI tool for this. Yeah, Vercel even has this like V0 tool that they use to be able basically generate website pieces of content within their framework. But like, I think the actual like interface and taking an interface and improving it, that will be a very difficult challenge for an AI coder to do because it's experiential. It's not testable in the traditional sense of coding. So next we have service integrations, and service integrations have this kind of challenge in that you usually have the service that exists, some website or something. You have an interface layer of how you make requests from that server or site. And then you are talking to something else, something not on the server. And so you need to be able to communicate with the other layer that exists, its ability to communicate what functions and capabilities it has for your service. And then you need to be able to then hit that service correctly and make the correct thing happen on the other end. So it's all about communication. That's really like the service integration thing is all communication. So it has to be, you know, correct on version of the interface. So oftentimes service layers update quite regularly. Sometimes they have a deprecation period, but if you're a few versions back, you can be making very different requests than maybe you might be intending. They must use interfaces correctly, right? And connect correctly. So the interface that you're using on your end needs to correctly communicate with their interface as well. And so that could be like different headers or different settings that need to be set. It could depend on like how your system is set up. Is it behind a firewall or a virtual network? So there could be these sorts of challenges as well. And then are you using the appropriate method to connect? And, you know, kind of the last step is really like testing to see if this whole thing works. Because if you're going to be doing the development or the coding, you need to be also checking that these things worked correctly, which means you need to be making these requests to services, and they could be like payment services. You could be actually like sending real money, and you need to know how to use a dummy account or mock data or some way to test these services without it being a real transaction. And then when you're ready to deploy, maybe you have a human actually do that part. Suffice it to say, this is a difficult challenge. And you know, there are existing solutions to this, like Zapier, right? They offer some great integrations for different services like Monday.com or something like that. But the problem is when you actually start looking through the different triggers and actions, it's not exhaustive. There are actions that you want to perform that are outside of this list. And this is the thing about like digital products, sort of like Zapier, these like no-code solutions. Oftentimes they sort of present so many possible solutions that you think it could do anything. But when you actually start diving in, they really just like don't. And that not only throws off like people, but it also throws off intelligent machine. Sometimes these interfaces, it's difficult to figure out what the actual correct interface is for your solution. Some things may sound right and you can go off on all sorts of different rabbit trails and misdirects and incorrect methods for getting to different things. At the end of the day, this is one of the hardest problems of programming is integration of systems. It's a very difficult challenge to do. And teams that wait to do it often suffer the consequences. That's something you need to do early and you need to very well understand if you're going to have an integration that exists in your system. I also wanted to include just standalone functions. I think standalone functions are probably the simplest. They're the most easy to automate. It's pretty simple. You have a coding function, you're going to give it some input and you're going to expect it to produce some sort of output. Could be computing a number in a certain way. It could be formatting something. These functions are sort of helpful for your code base to be able to do certain activities. And the introduction of these functions is definitely a very like automatable solution. And I think it's because you can very easily get the full context of the problem, of like how it should be solved. Very easy to also have these machines like improve upon these solutions to potentially like build out a more robust function because they kind of know all the pieces involved. There's not going to be a lot of different interfaces communicating across different layers. It's really always going to be input formatted a certain way and output formatted a certain way. And there's not going to be any real surprises here. And so it's also really easy to just like create unit tests. You can unit test these things, run, you know, you could write the tests first even, just say, hey, I know I'm going to have these sorts of inputs. I'm going to have these sorts of outputs. What should I be kind of looking for? And so I think that's like another really like powerful capability of this. So this already feels very good. The problem is it may not actually solve that solution the way that your code base wants it solved, right? The formatting, the standards, the way that you write code could completely feel like this disconnect in your library. So you may need to coax it, guide it, give it more context as well. Fairly reasonable. I think this is very possible. But also note that the thing has been trained on Stack Overflow. And when you look up certain answers to Stack Overflow, it may just say, you should just use sudo, which I think if you're most programmers, you realize that giving admin permissions is just not a great idea in general. And so, you know, this is a place where we have a lot of these systems that have been trained on ambiguous amounts of data and ambiguous ideas, and it may be difficult to get good mileage out of them because it's been hard for us to train it on good answers. We've certainly treated on data, but was it good data or not? That's a question. So the last one's fun. It's game. And I call it controllable software in that the sort of entire package of the software is sort of well understood in a way. And it's shippable independent of anything else. So if you wanted to write a game, you could write it on top of an emulator that can get you to a lot of different platforms, like Unity or different engines like that. There's also other aspects, like with the game engine, you have a lot of these different kind of specs of it, but none of these are like necessary. There are entire games where you don't have control or that don't have graphics, they're only text, or where there isn't any sound and that's part of the game design, or where there isn't an AI. It's really like you're kind of driving a lot of the game yourself, or where the interface is very simplistic in a way. So that's the other thing about like game development is that an AI that helps you with game development has a much more carefree space with which to operate. But we can look at like Doom. It was created in a year by a hardworking team that had already kind of gotten a game under its belt. And it, you know, took 100,000 man hours like total to create, build, and ship Doom. But if we think about like modern large scale software projects, 100,000 hours isn't really that much. If you get kind of closer to a million, then you kind of get into like the larger scale of projects. And that kind of goes to show like, well, okay, maybe it's dated. Games have come a long way, so now they're much bigger. And that, of course, is true. But also the challenge is really like games are flexible because they're not solving real problems. You're kind of solving this like fun thing that you want to make, but no one's going to lose money if it fails. If it crashes, you can kind of just restart it. It's not a big deal. So there aren't. There are kind of many pieces that are optional. And also like if the game is somewhat creative at edges or it does things that you don't necessarily expect, that could be a good thing. You can kind of rewrite how you're making the game as it's created. And so I think that's why like you end up seeing these sort of like interesting projects where, you can have a AI team create a game for you, an entire game for you for under a dollar in this example. And you can kind of go check out the 2-minute paper on this, but it's very like doable to create a game. And I think that's because it's a very controllable environment. So this is like, you know, so suffice it to say, really like the challenge of creating a standalone AI programmer that could come into your team is really like the types of problems you give them. And frankly, right now, there's not a lot of different problems that are that interesting to give an AI coder. So yeah, they can pretty much do standalone functions, but you don't want them rewriting your user interfaces. You don't want them integrating your services. And you might want them to help you make a game, but you might be surprised as to what it makes. So I think we're not quite there yet. I think we can still use awesome tools to help us with our creative work, writing code. But I just really don't think that a tool like Devin is really there yet, partially because this is a hard problem. And I just don't think it's going anywhere anytime soon. Thanks for watching. If you liked this, please subscribe on YouTube and give us a like. We also have a blog on Stable Discussion that we recently posted a little bit about Google Next and how Google's kind of evolving their AI strategy. We'd love it if you'd go over there, subscribe, and support us over there as well. Thanks so much. We'll catch you next.